In order to find the magnitude and coordinate direction angles alpha, beta, and gamma of the resultant force acting on the pole, we can start by first identifying the point coordinates of the two end of the rope along which the forces are being applied. So to start, point A lies at a distance of 4 meter in the x direction and 2 meter in the y direction, whereas along the z-axis it is equals to 0, whereas point B lies at a distance of 4 meter along the z-axis, so the point coordinates will be 0, 0, 4, whereas for F2, the head of that force lies at a distance of 2, negative 3, and 0, and finally for force F1, the point coordinates of the head will be at negative 3, 0, and 0. Once we have the point coordinates, we can go ahead and start writing the position vectors. So to start, let's look at force F1 of 350 Newton. Now to write the position vector, we take the difference between the point coordinates of head and tail. So in this case, it will be negative 3 minus 0i, 0 minus 0j, and 0 minus 4k. This will be our position vector. Next, we can calculate the magnitude of this position vector, that is coming equals to 5. Now we can go ahead and write our force F1 in the Cartesian vector form by multiplying the magnitude of the force, that is 350, with the unit vector of the line along which this force is acting. That unit vector can be calculated by taking the ratio of the position vector by its magnitude. So once we do the multiplication, the final value of F1 is coming as negative 210i. This is representing the component of the force along the x direction, and minus 280k, and this is the component along the z direction. Now once we have force F1, we can repeat the same process for F2. So to start, let's first go ahead and calculate the position vector of the line across which our force F2 is being applied. So taking the difference between the head and tail point coordinates, R2 will be equals to 2 minus 0i plus negative 3 minus 0j plus 0 minus 4k. Now, next we have to calculate the magnitude of this position vector. So to do that, taking the square root of 2 is square plus negative 3 is square and plus negative 4 is square give us the value of 5.38. Once we have the magnitude, we again need to convert it into a unit vector by taking the ratio of the position vector divided by its magnitude, and finally multiplying that unit vector with the magnitude of force F2, that is 250. Once we do that, we get our final value of F2 in the Cartesian form as 92.8i minus 139.3j and minus 185.7k newtons. Now, once we have these two forces, the process is still the same. We will repeat the same thing for our force F3. So to do for force F3, again, we will start with our position vector of the line across which force F3 is being applied, doing our head minus tail process. R3 will be equals to 4 minus 0i, 2 minus 0, and 0 minus 4k. Once we have this, again taking the magnitude of this position vector, so a square root of 4 is square plus 2 is square plus negative 4 is square give us the value of 6. Now, once we have this position vector and its magnitude, now we can write our F3 in the Cartesian vector form by multiplying the magnitude of force F3, that is 300, times the unit vector of the line across which this force is being applied. So once we multiply these two terms, we get our final force F3 as 200i plus 100j minus 200k. Now, once we have all of the three forces in its Cartesian vector form, we can go ahead and start writing the resultant force that will be basically sum of F1 plus F2 plus F3. Now, the only thing that we have to be careful while we are adding these forces, we have to make sure that we add the x component with the x component. In other words, all the I components will be added together, all the j components will be added together, and all the k components will be added together to represent our resultant force. Once we do that, we are getting the final value of resultant force as 82.8 I negative 39.3 j minus 665.7 k, and this is our final resultant force representing in Cartesian vector form. Now here the question is asking us to determine the magnitude and coordinate direction angles alpha, beta and gamma of the resultant force acting on the pole. So we can start by first figuring out the magnitude of this resultant force. Now if you recall, we can calculate the magnitude of the force by taking the square root of all the square terms of x, y, and z components added together. So in this case, the resultant magnitude will be equals to a square root of 82.8 square plus negative 39.3 square plus negative 665.7 square. Simplifying, we get the resultant force as 672 newtons. Now, once we have the resultant, we can go ahead and calculate the coordinate direction angles. Now, if you recall, coordinate direction angles is basically representing the angle the resultant force is making with respect to its x, y, and z axis respectively. So, to start, we will calculate alpha, that is the angle the resultant force is making with respect to the x-axis, by taking the cos inverse of the x component of the resultant force divided by the magnitude of the resultant force. So that is coming equals to 82.9 degrees. Next, we can repeat the process for beta. That will be equals to cos inverse of negative 39.3 divided by 672. That is coming equals to 93.4. And finally, gamma is equals to cos inverse of negative 665.7 divided by 672. And that is equals to 172 degrees.